Chassam Sofer tells us that there was a certain tefillah that was written so that it should be said every Matzah Yom Kippur. Except Klal Yisrael took this tefillah and adapted it so that they say it and sing it every single Matzah Shabbos. It's a famous song, many of us certainly will recognize the words. Referring to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we say Matzah Shabbos, HaMavdil Ben Kodesh L'Chol. HaKadosh Baruch Hu, who separates between that which is holy and that which is secular, Chatzeinu Hu Yivchol. Our Averus, He should forgive. Zareinu V'Kasteinu Yarvet HaKadosh. Our children and our money should increase like the sand, but like the stars at night. Sand has a certain mila, and stars have a certain mila. Sand has a mila that there's nothing in the world that is as abundant as the particles of sand on the seashore. Stars have a mila that they are bright and that they shine for the whole world. Tonight, we have come for the benefit of Zareinu. We have come to speak about Kasteinu, to speak about our money. Let us hope that all of us here tonight and all of us in Klal Yisrael will be such that our children and that our money will increase to such a countless amount like the particles of sand. But perhaps even more important, that our children's accomplishments and the accomplishments that we do with our money should be like a bubble, should be a shining and a guiding light for all the world. The Torah tells us that when Avraham Avinu sent Eliezer to get a shita for his own son Yitzchak, Avraham Avinu, the Torah tells us, by Yoimer Avraham in Bereishis Chafdal Zeh, Avram said, El Avdai, to his servants, to Kanzeisai, Amoshel B'chol HaShelot. The one who rules over everything that he has. The Pasuk of Pshat in the Pasuk is that Eliezer was the ruler over everything. He was in control of all Avram Avinu's possessions. But the Klei Yofar tells us a tremendous shock in these words, Amoshel B'chol HaShelot, which will be our theme for tonight. The Klei Yofar writes in the New Chaloimer, we can say, Shemilas Loi, that word Loi, HaMoshel B'chol HaShel Loi, is going on Eliezer's possession. Eliezer rules over his possession. He rules over his money, not that his money rules over him. And the Klei Yofar writes, Mishahu Loz Acharpentas HaMoma, anybody who runs after his tremendous title of money, Mamona Shalatola, his money rules over him, and he has no control. But over here, now we see why Avraham Avinu trusted Eliezer. Because Eliezer was a Moshe, he ruled over his money, and therefore he was able to trust him with the Shira. Because the Torah is telling us, Al Kane Moya Kriku Hamama Lata Saburoi Mashainoi Roi Kanoka. He wasn't going to do anything for the sake of the dollar that was wrong. And so we have to remember not only why she's doing it. If money is everything that's involved either with a shopman or with the shit of itself, that's either Roi Kanoka. That's not proper. But the Torah is telling us more than that. Somebody who is Lord after Mumbai, somebody who does not rule over his money, but his money rules over him, then he has to suspect that he's going to do things for the sake of the dollar that are not Erlach and that are not money. The Gemara tells us, the Medrash in Tehillim, on quite fair, Aleph, Basakut Gimel, that no person ain't Adam Yosei Mina Oilam Bechatsi Taibasa Biyodai. When a person leaves from this world, he has not fulfilled half of the desire that he would have wanted for his money. Anybody who has 100 wants to make 200 assets. Anybody who has 200 wants to make 400 assets. We always want to make more money, and we want to hold on to it as much and as long as we can. My son went to a clothing store, not to mention where, before Yom Kippur. So So he goes into the fellow and he buys cloak, whatever he needed. And then he says to the fellow, can I pay you by check? So the guy says, yeah, for sure you can pay me by check. So my son says, how can I make it out? So the guy says, my name is Chaim Avram Shaya Horowitz. Make it out to my initials. Chaim Avram Shaya Horowitz. That wasn't his name. You know what it spells. And that's somebody who wants to hold on to the money. He doesn't want to report it. He doesn't want to give it over to anyone. See, you have to figure it out. It's called cash. Before the Philistine was going to go to Eretz Yisrael, he wrote a letter to his family. And in the beginning of the letter, he writes, please, he writes to his family, don't be so obsessed and don't be so impressed with rich people and riches. He writes, the world is like people who drink salty water. They drink gallons of salty water, and they think that they're satiated and they're not going to be thirsty, but it only makes them more thirsty. Because again, he quotes, ain't other maid, but not the other. Nobody dies without having fulfilled less than half of what he wants. Everybody is into money. And yet, Shlomo HaMelech warns us in Tehillim. In first, in Perek, you are supposed to just in your chest. But I shall tell you, if you're going to be lazy, Yimachamakara, the ceiling is going to sag. Ubishif moves your dying, and if your hands are going to be idle, give my Tabayim, the house is going to leak. You've got to work. You've got to make money. And the next topic tells us, Sahakesef Yanetakoy. Money is the answer for everything. And Rashi tells us a sad fact of life, the main Kesef ain't Judah. If you don't have money, you're not going to eat. And you're not going to be able to pay the rent, and you're not going to pay the mortgage, and you're not going to be able to marry up your kids, and you're not going to buy food, you're not going to buy clothes. And how your shiva is going to be built. Rosh Yeshiva is not to go out and make everybody know that's what they want. And it's embarrassing. Rosh Yeshiva is not to go out and ask for money. But you can't build the yeshiva, you can't build the baby up, but we need money. The Shatan Rebbe once went to raise money for the yeshiva. So he came to a fellow, and the guy gives him $47. So the Rebbe says to him, surely, what's that, this $47? So he says, Rebbe, the Gematria, your name, Yoyos. So the Rebbe says, it's a high collector of Stephen Yoyos. You can be sure that guy paid another 300. But our grandparents, and our great-grandparents, many of them came to be sure because America was referred to as the Golden of Medina. Many people felt that if they only could make a good salary today, they would have security tomorrow. But never, never, never. For thousands of people, the American dream has become the American nightmare. And we read every day where thousands and thousands of jobs have been lost over the last 10 years. And even though there are thousands and thousands of jobs have been created, but many of those jobs require less skill, they afford less pay, and they're less rewarding. And so today we live in difficult financial times. Who ever heard of a bank going bankrupt? Who ever heard of financial institutions going under? But today, it's a very difficult financial situation. And so we live in a society on one hand that's obsessed with the dollar. And yet we live in a society that so many people are overwhelmed by the lack of the dollar. So whether people have an abundance of money or the absence of money, we are many times pained by the dollar. And that's perhaps another shot that the author of Yeshuni writes, Ba'akesef Yaneh, Yaneh for the Lashon of Inui. Inui means it afflicts people, whether you have too much money or too little money, unless you have the right of surplus, you're going to become afflicted by the dollar. If we have a lot of money, we have to know how to handle it. And if we have too little money, we have to know how to handle the situation. So now let us see what the Torah, let us see what Chazal, let us see what Gedolim and the generation, how they understood the value of money and how they felt should be our approach to money. So let me tell you an interesting story that happened with Rav Yaakov Kamenevsky. Rav Yaakov Kamenevsky, when he first came, to New York. He was a Rosh Hashiva in Faradah. Now Rav Geiger, when he was in Slavotcha, he was a Bocher, and then eventually in the Koilel, he was learning one particular Gemara in Gittin and he couldn't figure it out. Very difficult piece of Gemara. I wish I knew which Gemara it was. But the one who told me the story, by the time he told me the story, he was already older and he didn't remember. It was Rav Pinchas Tzitzis and Elizabeth. He told me the story, Rav Yaakov told it to him. So, when Rav Yaakov was in Slavotcha, he would ask the Bachur in the next message, then he asked the human life of the Kodesh. And every place that he went, he tried to find out what the Pshat was. And then when he was in Toronto, and he spoke to the Tamid HaChaman, nobody had Pshat. Now he came to Faradah, and this was in the 1940s, and he was giving his daily shiur. And he was always worried, what's going to happen when I have to give a shiur to young, impressionable boys, and we're going to get to this Nachum Gittin? I'm going to have to tell them, I don't know. And they're going to go to the board of directors and say, the rabbi, the Rosh Hashiva, he doesn't know the Gemara, so what's the difference between him and you? We don't know the Gemara, and he doesn't know the Gemara. They weren't sophisticated in learning in the 1940s, like they are today, that you understand that the Shver of Gemara, and you don't understand Shas. So Rav Geiger was very worried about it. And sure enough, the cycle of the Gemara came, sure enough, it came to Nachum Gittin. And sure enough, it came to Yoram. And what night he knows that the men say he's going to have to give that shiur. And he's going to tell the boy that he doesn't know the Pshat because Rabbi Yaakov was a Nishama. So what happens? He opens up the Gemara and he's sitting in front of the shiur. And as he's saying the Gemara, a Pshat falls into his head. And he can't believe it. After all these years, the Pshat came into his head. And it's the right Pshat that makes sense. And he says to the Bokhrim, Bokhrim, I can't believe it. All these years, it's La Bocha. Yoga life couldn't figure it out, I couldn't figure it out, and now, right now, I figured it out. And of course he told it to the Bachman, and then he went to visit Talmid Chachamim in Williamsburg, and they were all Muslim, that was the right shot. And Rabbi Yaakov was trying to figure out how did that happen. And it is brilliant, he came up with a tremendous shot how such a thing could have happened to him. And this is what he told Rav Pinchas Tzitzis, and this is what Rav Tzitzis told him. Rav Yaakov says the Gemara tells us in Megillat Avraham Avinu. Famous Gemara. In Olam HaAdam, if a person tells you, Yogati, I worked very hard, the Lord of Zaki, and I didn't find it, don't believe him. Because if you work hard, you're going to find it. And if somebody says, I didn't work hard, and I found it, also don't believe him. Nothing comes easy. So if somebody says, I worked hard and I found it, then you believe him. So Rav Yaakov says like this. The Gemara tells us further, when is this rule in effect? Han Billy to Divrei Torah. That's only by Divrei Torah. But the Masa, when it comes to business, Siyat Rumin Shemaya. Everything is only Siyat Rumin Shemaya and has nothing to do with Siyat Rumin Shemaya. Because like in all these years, I was learning Torah Lishma in Slavotcha and then later in Toronto. And to this point, Hashem said, look, you didn't work hard enough. You don't deserve it. Why not? Why was not? But now I'm giving a shiur. I'm getting paid to give this shiur. This is business. Shachem and Shemaiah. Hey, Mr. Gaines, it's Shachem and Shemaiah. Not that I worry about it. Shachem and Shemaiah. That's a different ballgame. Different rules altogether. We see something remarkable here. We see that somebody could work very hard. And we know people who work very hard. They're not going to be successful in business. And we see people that don't necessarily work so hard, and they're very successful in business. And you know what the answer is? The answer is it's Yadav Shemayim. Every youth has to understand that Masa Umasa business is Yadav Shemayim. You have to work, but it has nothing to do with how hard you're going to work. That's the first rule we have to remember. Business is a different ballgame. Everything is totally in the way the Ebishter wants it to happen in Yadav Shemayim. So I ask you, if we want to have bracha, shouldn't we daven every day for bracha shemineser? The whole shemineser should be filled that we should ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu for bracha. And yet in the entire shemineser, the middle part when we ask Hashem for all the different things, we know shemineser is divided into three parts. The first part is sheva, we give praise. The second part is bakasha, we ask. And the last part is vayda, we say thank you. no place do we get a bracha except by parnasa. By that bracha of parnasa, not only do we ask once, but if you daven Ashkenaz, you ask four times. And if you daven Yosef Sfar like Isaac, you ask six times. Over and over and over, you're asking about bracha. Listen. Borek Aleinu Hashem Alekeinu Hashem Ha'atoy. That's so many swaths of the Torah. That's Borek, the first time. The same bracha or the same talamad of the bracha, whatever season it is. Second. The Sabeinu Mitzuma, Uborek Shem Alekeinu Hashem Ha'atoy. Again, Uborek. And it's again, like you say, five of the bracha says again. Kikel Toy Kato Uborek Hashem. Baruch Atah Hashem, Uborek Hashem. Why are we asking so many times bracha, bracha, bracha? And only in that bracha when it comes to parnasa. And I'll tell you what I think the reason is. I think the reason is because really parnasa is a curse. What can Hashem say to other Marishan? Bereshis you said, B'zeyat Abeha, B'chalasa. With the sweat of your brow, you're going to eat bread. That was a curse. So we ask Hashem, please undo that curse. You gave us a klala, now we want bracha. We're asking for bracha and bracha and bracha to undo that terrible klala. And I'll tell you something very interesting. This has nothing to do with our topic, but I cannot resist telling you that how the Kleyoker learns this pasuk b'zeyas abecha b'chalecha. It's so remarkable. Your Torah is so rich. You learn one thing and you see something else. This is absolutely remarkable, and it shows me it's only another one. That even when Hashem is cursing Adam, the Zayas Abraham said to Adam, he's telling him a good thing. Listen to the good thing. That the Tanya, you can look it up if you don't believe it. In Gimel Yotet, he writes, here is a lesson to do exercise before you eat. Yeshmach Mishan, Lefira Elayshin, this is what the doctors are telling us. Shekhoid and Zolachila before you go out and eat. You should walk around the park, do some exercises, start up other lots of days of Malacha. Why? Bezeyat Abraham. When you sweat it, that's going to help the digestive system. So if you want to know where you go, the tyrant is not that exercise, then say it's not going to hurt Allah. There's no worse to tell you. It's terrific. You have not much of a walker to walk up and down Ocean Parkway. But I find such doubt that even when I put it for us, it's cursing. All the research, he's giving us good advice. But say it's not going to hurt Allah. When I was preparing this talk, something came into my mind so remarkable that I was positive it was so good that it had to be written in Svarim. Sure enough, I found it in Svarim. Listen to this thing, this is absolutely remarkable. I was looking at the word milchama. Milchama is war. What are the middle letters of the word milchama? Lamed, ches, men, lechem. I think there's a great lesson there. That to get bread, to put bread on the table, it's a war, it's a battle. As a matter of fact, once I thought of that and I thought that I'm from Polish, I started telling it to everyone. So I have a brother on Lake with a few to Abraham, and he said to me, what are you talking about? You don't realize there's a whole bunch of words that mean food and mean war and battle? I said, no. And he showed me words, all words that we know. Listen to this, it's remarkable. We all know Terech. In Tehillim Kufyud Aleph Beis says, Terech not on the way. Terech means sustenance, food. What happened when Yaakov Avinu saw that Terech had fasted? He cried out, Toroi Torah, they say. Surely he was torn to bits. Terech is sustenance. But Terech means to fight and to tear to bits. The word Mitzayin has Zion, Zon. Zon is sustenance. But Zion, play Zion is ammunition. Again, fighting. Yeshev. What did Yaakov Avinu say? Yeshev in Mitzrayim. There's food in Mitzrayim. We all know Shever is from the Lashon of Shvira, breaking. Michyo, Allah Michyo. What is Michyo? Michyo is sustenance. Michyo Amalek is wiping out. Fighting, wiping out Amalek. And one more. Vayar, Pesher, Rabbeinu Tov, Asnet, Eimenu, Ukol. It's not being consumed. Ukol is like Oichel food. So whether it's Lechem and Luchoma, Teres, Mezayin, Shever, Michyo, Oichel, we have to battle, we have to fight, we have to snatch can use our brains and our brawns and our talents and our energy. It's not easy making a parnosa. If somebody doesn't make a good parnosa, you can't blame them. It's a battle out there. And the Torah is telling us that. It's a war. It's not easy to make parnosa. But it is a battlefield. And there are winners on every battlefield. So who are the winners in this battlefield of parnosa? And the Gemara tells us something very interesting in Shabbos Lamed Aleph Amud Aleph. The Gemara tells us, B'shashem achnisin adam l'zir, when a person is going to go up to Shemayim after 120 years, what's the first question he's going to be asked? Not how many years he did, not how much prayer he learned. The Gemara in Shabbos Lamed Aleph Amud Aleph tells us the first question is, Nosoto v'nasata v'emuno. Were you honest in business? Were you erudite? That's the first thing that you're going to be asked. Then I can ask you, how many commissions did you make on all those insurance policies? Then I can ask the woman, how many shekels did you sell? Or how many walls did you decorate? Or they're going to ask, then I can ask somebody, how many properties did you manage? Or how many businesses were you going to foster in? Then I can ask these questions. You know what they're going to ask? They're going to bring up a teacher. And they're going to say to the teacher, did you really prepare those lessons properly? Or did you come up to the class and think you could just ad-lib it? Or they're going to ask somebody who was in business, did you fabricate lies about your competition? Were you ever in business? Did you pay your bills on time? Did you inflate the deductible on the insurance so that you shouldn't have to pay any money? Were you honest in business? That's the first thing they're going to ask. Let me tell you a story about happened with a lady. I guess just recently she works in a real estate office. So the real estate office, the guy tells her, listen, you've got to go out and show this property. And he says to the lady, room lady, he says, don't forget, you got to tell them that it's worth $10,000 more than it really is worth. Because, you know, we want to sell this property. So she says, I can't do that. That's not honest. He says, yeah, but we're trying to sell this property. She says, yeah, we're trying to sell this property. The property is for sale, but my religion is not for sale. That's an answer. That's eloquence. A young man once came to our Michelle Salanter, our gift, told me this story. And one young man once came to our Michelle Salanter and he said, Rebbe, I have to quit my job. He says, what's your job? He said, I'm a shaytan. He says, you're a shaytan and a boyden. Such a heavy job of life, so why do you want to quit? He said, that's exactly the reason. I get such an arthritis. What if my chalos is not perfect? What if when I have to check the lungs and the circuit and I don't do a perfect job? I'm going to be Michael, Claudius Roman Traces. I can't have that on my conscience. And then if the butcher wants I should tell him that the animal is kosher, even though it's not, I can't have that on my conscience. So he said, so what do you want to do? And then I'll be a plain businessman. I just want to go into business, simple businessman. Shabbos also has to set them like this. He said, tell me, did you learn the smicha? Yes. How many years did you learn? 2 years. Did you have a fire? Yes, you had a fire. And you chas it over the halacha many times? Yes. So you chas it over the halacha, and you went there, and you went over all the halachas, and you studied. And because of one avera that you don't want to be mindful, praiseless, look what a businessman, if you go into business, what you have to worry about. Loy signoi, you didn't steal. Loy signoi, loy sakmoi, loy sakmoi, that you didn't cheat. Loy signoi, you didn't agree with anybody to say something wrong about a property that you were going to buy or that you sold. Loy accomplishment, that's to deny. There's so many averas. Did you cut it? Did you learn like your mishpat? What do you think, generally, if you go into business? There's 10 times more averas in business than there is in shtika. So Rav Kifta told me that he once told over this story, and a year later, two of his talmidim called him. And you know what they said? They said, Rebbe, last year we heard the shir from you. And we were so taken by the shir that we decided to make a seder on Chayshu Mishpat. And every day we can tell you that now we see everything in our system, things that we did that were wrong in the years before. Talmud of Halacha, that's what we're going to be asked. Will you hear us? Listen to this story. I don't think I ever told this story over in public. Certainly not here. What happened with Rav Elie Kushnitzer, the Chazayim said he was from the Lama Kof Tzadikim. He was a Mashiach in the Lama Yeshiva. Rav Shalosh was from the Magid of Yishalayim and Yishalayim and Yishalayim and when he was a little boy he went to this Yeshiva. And everybody knew that Rav Elie Kushnitzer had an orange parka. A parka of oranges. And he was getting older. And he had a lot of debt. It really wasn't his in the beginning. He had taken it over from his son. His son got it as an adult. and he owed tremendous amounts of money. So he said, how can I die and owe so much money? I've got to sell this bargain. So everybody who he saw, he said, please daven for me. Tell the little children in the yeshiva they should daven that I should be able to sell this bargain. So it happened a year later, one of his talmidim went into business, and this guy was selling different properties or whatever, and a fellow from America comes, and he says to this guy, he says, look, I'd like to buy a bargain. He says, oh, a bargain! My rebbe is trying to sell a bargain. That's terrific. So let me hook you up with my rebbe. So he calls Rabbi Yehoshua and said, come to Yerushalayim, and they all get on the bus and they travel to a place called Bir Shalom, right outside of Tel Aviv. And this American businessman is sitting next to the Mashiach, Rabbi Yehoshua said, I saw a picture of him, I'm a tzaddik. So Rabbi Yehoshua just says to this American girl, he says, you know, I want to tell you the Gemara. The Gemara of Bava Metzia says, of Tessa Mitzvah, Misha, he has like all his moi karpe, if a father left a lot of money to a son, and the son wants to be sure that it's going to get lost, he should just hire workers and not look after them. Then you know for sure that the workers aren't going to do a good job, and you'll lose your money in no time. He says, excuse me, you want to buy this bargain, but are you going to be in the Eretz Yisrael, or are you going back to America? He says, I'm going back to America. He says, you're going back to America, I can't sell you the bargain. It's ridiculous. These workers, they won't take care of it, they're going to lose all your money, I can't sell it to you. He says, no, Rebbe, don't worry, I want to buy it anyway. They're traveling on the bus. And a buddy says to him, you know, I want to tell you something. In the northwest corner of the pardon, that there's a few orange trees that the sun doesn't get there, and they don't grow oranges. So I just want you to know that. And the Talmud calls him, because now he sees why the pardon is not being sold. So he says, no, don't worry, I'll buy it anyway. And after getting close, he says, you know, I'm going to tell you about the southwest corner. On the southwest corner, there's a lot of rocks there. And a lot of stones, so it's very heavy, and the ground is always, it sinks in and it doesn't grow. So you got a problem in the northwest and in the southwest. He says, no, Rebbe, don't worry, I want to buy it anyway. Finally, they come outside, and he's walking around the park, and all of a sudden the man looks at his watch, and he says, quick, and he takes out a pill from a little bottle, and he swallows one down. So the belly says to him, what is this? He says, ah, I have a little heart condition. I have to take a pill. A heart condition? A heart condition? Are you going to buy this bargain? That's the shovel. There's no way I'm selling it to you. There's the hell of some Arabic labor. And he wouldn't sell it to him. So Rav Shoshana always says, why did Hashem make it that this person should have to come all the way to the bargain and look at it and then not end up with it? He said, of course, they used to want it. You should get a cover from a lot of folks on it. But Lamaite, at the end, it happened. That he had another Talmud who wanted to ship it and made sure, and he told the Bachman that they'd do it, and eventually he was able to sell it. But how does that happen? Why does that happen? Because this, from all your distance, was somebody who, when it comes to Shemayim, or came to Shemayim, he's able to answer the question that he was there about. There's another way to be victorious when it comes to money matters. The Gemara tells us to leave an iron on the face, my Yasser, all of you, what should a person do? And he'll become wealthy. So the Gemara says he should be involved in business. Palestine. So the Gemara says, a lot of people did that, that didn't help. So the Gemara says, El Yafaki Shirachamim, the Misha Moshe Shalom. You have to daven to the one who the wealth is his. And the Gemara at the end says, Michael Mashmalon, you gotta have both. You have to work and you have to daven. And the Gemara Kedushin Pei from an Allah tells us something very interesting. Rav Meir says that every father should teach his son an easy job, an easy and a clean job. He just follow the Misha Oishim and a Muslim Shalei and a Shazala. And listen to this. She'eina Ovis She'eifay Amiyis Mashirim. Every single job has wealthy people and poor people. There are many people that are selling tables and making a fortune. There are people that are selling furniture and they're making a fortune. There are people that are selling dinettes and they're not making any money whatsoever. There are people that draw, that are artists, they make a fortune. And there are many people that are artists and they can't even put bread on the table. There are many people that are selling peanuts and popcorn and they're making a fortune. And there are many people that are selling peanuts and popcorn and that's what they're making, peanuts and popcorn. They're making nothing. Because the Gemara tells us, Shalai Ami has been on this. The poverty doesn't come from the job. The Lord has serious men on this. Everything is according to your schusim. Everything is with Yad Vashem. And that's what we have to remember.